which heaven's joys o'erbrighten.
More to our study of how to interpret the Bible. The last time we were together, we were talking about basically law and incidentals. We came to the realization that any law that God gives, or for that matter that a man gives, has certain things which are included within it, certain other things that would be clear violations of that law, and then some things that are incidental. They're included, but they're included by us. We choose to add them in to help us do the job. So a fellow that's edging a lawn might prefer to go out and get a power edger of some sort instead of having to do it by hand, for instance. We do that with a lot of things. When we studied that, we came to the realization that God has set forth laws for us to follow, but that oftentimes there are a few things that are left open to our choice. The only thing we cannot choose is something that is coordinate to a thing. Like, for example, if God specifies lamb, a particular type of meat, we cannot choose to replace that with pork or with oxen or whatever else that we might choose. We have to stay with lamb. Now, it's important before we close out our study entirely for us to realize that the Bible is a complete revelation from God. You know, we live in an era when many people claim to have new revelations, that God is speaking them to them today, or He's speaking to someone within their religious organization today, telling them what to do, telling them changes that need to be made, and things on that order. But the reality is that the Bible does not leave any idea of something to follow. Now, I should hasten to say the Old Testament did. The Old Testament looked forward to something to follow. For example, Moses said that God had foretold through him that there would be a prophet like unto him who would come. Well, obviously, that has to be after Moses' time. You get to Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, that we looked at a few weeks ago, and it talks about a virgin conceiving and bearing a child. Once more, a prophecy that required the coming of Christ in order to be fulfilled. The great promise that God made to Adam and Eve and the serpent, in that there would be an enmity, an animosity, if you would, between the serpent and his seed, and the woman and her seed, but that ultimately, though the serpent would be able to bruise the heel of woman's seed, that woman's seed would destroy the head or deal a mortal blow to the serpent. All those things look forward. That looks forward to the coming of Jesus and the conquering of the grave, which would free everyone from any problem whatsoever with death. Now, the New Testament, though, on the other hand, does not leave any idea of something to come other than the Lord coming back to claim His own and take them to heaven. Other than that, there's no foreseeable message out there, no new thing that God is going to reveal. Instead, quite the contrary, the New Testament is written as if it is the final revelation from God. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, Paul says, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, throughly furnished unto every good work." Notice really those last few words, "throughly furnished unto every good work." If man can be completely outfitted for every good work, then there's no need for God to write anything else. Whatever we do in God's service is a good work. And since we have the complete manifestation of the things that we need to do those good works, then there's nothing yet to come. In the book of 2 Peter, chapter 1, the Apostle Peter in verse 2 says, "Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, as His divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by glory and virtue." Notice, He's given us all things. Skip on down. In verse 10, Peter goes on to say, "Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble." So we now know that Peter says that we have all things that pertain to life and godliness. And if we do the things that are revealed, then we can be assured that we will not fall. The Apostle Paul, in writing to the brethren at Galatia, recognized that there was a problem there. And the problem arose because someone was teaching something beyond the revelation of God. Listen to what Paul's warning is for those brethren at that time, beginning in verse 6 of Galatians 1. "I marvel that you are turning away so soon from Him who called you into the grace of Christ to a different gospel, which is not another, but there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than that which we have preached to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, so say I now again, if anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed." So notice, Paul indicates there is but one gospel. It's clear that he believes that gospel has already been delivered. And that if anybody changes that, adds to it, takes away from it, that individual should be accursed in the eyes of God. Clearly, Paul thought that the revelation was complete. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16, as Paul closes out that book to the brethren at Corinth, he makes an interesting statement in verse 13. "Watch, stand fast in the faith, be strong." Now think about it. Stand fast in the faith. That seems to indicate the faith is complete, that it's already available so that we can stand fast in it, that we can be assured in it, that we don't have to look for something else, turning to one side and then the other, but that instead we have it, we ought to remain strong in it, we ought to be ready to defend it, so to speak. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, the Apostle Paul writes to the young preacher, Timothy. This likely will be his last letter to him. It may even be their last communication. He's not sure because his death is imminent at the time. And so what would he say to the young preacher? What message would he convey to him? Well, the answer, I think, in part, is found right here. "I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at His appearing and His kingdom." Now that's a pretty serious charge. Just think about it. Who are the two witnesses to this charge that Paul is issuing? Well, God the Father. And then second, the Lord Jesus Christ. So what is this serious charge that Paul's going to deliver? Preach the Word. Be ready in season, out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. And they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. But you, be watchful in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. You know, within that passage, there's some pretty clear indicators. First of all, preach the Word. Not something that is yet to be revealed, but instead apparently something that is already revealed. In fact, he says, be ready. Be ready all the time. Be ready when it's in season. You know, that's when it's easy to do something. Be ready out of season. Well, it's not so easy, but be ready nonetheless. Why? Because men at some point in time are going to seek their own way. They're going to want to hear what they want to hear. They will not want to hear the truth. But the truth has been delivered. It is there. It is available. And so it's for that reason that Paul urges Timothy, be faithful in all things. You've got the word here. Hold firm to it. Clearly, God in His word has let us know that He has delivered exactly what we need for this time. There is nothing that is yet to follow in terms of a revelation from God to man. We also need to observe beyond that, that the Bible makes a claim to completeness. Turn with me now to the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 1, or chapter 2, excuse me, verses 9 and 10. And listen to what the apostle there tells the brethren of Colossae. For in Him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in Him, who is the head of all principality and power. It's quite interesting to observe how God has dealt with man. In the early going, God dealt directly with man. He talked to the fathers, men like Noah, Enoch, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. But then He began to speak to man through Moses. He delivered a law, but it was not a perfect law. Not perfect in the sense that it had no provision in case man should sin. What it was intended to do instead, it fully fulfilled. And that is, it was intended to show that man was a sinner in need of a Savior, that some sacrifice needed to be offered. And without that sacrifice, there would be no hope. But then God sent His Son. It's interesting that the writer of Hebrews, when he writes about it, says, God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by His Son, whom He hath appointed heir of all things, and by whom also He made the worlds. Do you hear that? He, in the last days, has spoken by His Son. Significantly, as we've already observed in this series, the Holy Spirit came not to deliver a new message, but instead to deliver the message of Jesus Christ, to remind them of what He had already said, and to finish telling them about the things that He could not say while on earth because they were not yet ready for it. We need to realize that the Bible then is laying a claim to completeness. At long last, we have a spokesman in whom dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. But then turn over to the book of Hebrews, for it seems to agree with what we've already been studying. When in Hebrews chapter 13, beginning at verse 20, the writer tells us further, Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do His will, working in you what is well-pleasing in His sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Notice the kind of words that he uses there. The blood of the everlasting covenant, for instance. Notice that he talks about complete in every good work to do His will. Working what is well-pleasing. All of those things seem to lay forth a claim to completeness. We have what we need. Go back to Hebrews chapter 10. And beginning at verse 7, notice what is written there that seems to add to and help to better explain what we've just been talking about. Here is Jesus being spoken of. And it says, Then I said, Behold, I have come. In the volume of the book it is written of me, to do your will, O God. Previously saying, Sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings and offerings for sin you did not desire, nor had pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law. Then he said, Behold, I have come to do your will, O God. He takes away the first, that he may establish the second. By that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ. Now watch these words. Once for all, God has sent his Son to make the one sacrifice that was necessary for all time to set men free from their bondage to sin and death. And so, in verse 26 of the same chapter, the writer continued, "For if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful expectation of judgment and a fiery indignation, which will devour the adversaries." Don't you see? He is saying that there's no further provision. Now that Jesus has come, now that that sacrifice has been made, there is nothing else that remains. If you and I spurn the sacrifice of Jesus, if we push it aside and have nothing to do with it, then God has no other plan. This is the culmination of God's plan to bring man back to Him and cause man to be able to live with Him in eternity. The blood of Jesus is the means by which we may be set free. But the people of the Old Testament did not heed the warnings. And in fact, the writer of Hebrews goes on and talks about that and springboards from that into a warning for us. In verse 28 of Hebrews 10, he continues, "Anyone who has rejected Moses' law dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. Of how much worse punishment do you suppose will he be thought worthy who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, counted the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified a common thing, and insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord." And again, "The Lord will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. But I recall the former days in which, after you were illuminated, you endured a great struggle with sufferings, partly while you were made a spectacle, both by reproaches and tribulations, and partly while you became companions of those who were so treated. For you had compassion on me in my chains and joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods, knowing that you have a better and an enduring possession for yourselves in heaven. Therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise." So listen to him. The promise is there. It is available for us. We do have the complete revelation from God, and clearly the New Testament makes that claim. But now, we want to also notice that Jude tells us the faith was once for all delivered. In Jude verse 3, Jude wrote this powerful statement, "Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning the common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints." Now the words "for all" are in italics, therefore they are provided. And yet, really in some ways, that is the sense of the word that is used here. The word "once" means once for all time, that which is perpetually valid, that which needs no repetition. What is it that Jude is saying is perpetually valid? What is it that he's saying will never be needing repetition again? The answer, the faith. The faith which was once delivered. When Vine looked at that word, faith, in his expository dictionary of New Testament words, he said, "By metonymy, the sum of all that is believed." Now remember, metonymy is one of those figures of speech we looked at before. And we do use it, we just don't think about it all the time. For example, remember the teacher we talked about? She's going on a field trip with her students, but before they leave the school ground, she says, "Okay, let's count heads." Well, we noted then that she's not just taking the heads, she's taking the whole child in each case. But the head is representative of the entirety. You think of the head, you think of the whole body. When you call out a name to me, the first thing that comes to mind is the head of that individual. I don't think about their whole body, I think about their head. And so by metonymy, those two have come to basically be conjoined. Say the one, think the other. That's the idea here. So in this case, Vine is saying the word faith is spoken, and it makes us realize or think about the will of God. The entire will of God for man is summarized in that one word, faith. Jude is saying the faith, the sum of all that is believed, has been once for all delivered to the saints, and we need to be prepared to defend it. You know, really, that should not surprise us, because that is precisely what Jesus promised. Go back to the book of John, John chapter 16, and read again with me. See what Jesus said that the role of the Holy Spirit would be, particularly beginning in verse 12 of John 16. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. However, when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will guide you into all truth. For He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He will speak, and He will tell you things to come. He will glorify Me, for He will take of what is Mine and declare it to you. So what was the role of the Spirit? The role of the Spirit was to deliver entirely all truth. He was to guide them into all truth. And now Jude tells us in his little epistle that that has been accomplished. Someone very well has written about the Bible that this book contains the mind of God, the state of man, the way of salvation, the doom of sinners, and the happiness of the righteous. Its doctrines are holy, its precepts binding, its records are true, and all its decisions are immutable. Read it to be wise, believe it to be safe, and practice it to be holy. It contains light to direct you, food to support you, and comfort to cheer you. It is the traveler's map, the pilgrim's staff, the pilot's compass, the soldier's sword, the Christian's charter. And indeed it is. Our goal in this series of lessons has been to help you be able to take up the Bible and understand more fully what God had in mind for you and for me. Interpreting the Bible is very much like interpreting any other book. You've got to come to understand certain things about it if you really want to appreciate what is being said. For example, as we noted way back at the beginning, we have to look and say, when was this written? To whom was it written? By whom was it written? All those things are important. I'm glad that I know about Noah and his relationship with God, but I don't need to build an ark, and neither do you, in order to be pleasing to God. I am thankful for the report of the faithfulness of Abraham, and yet again, I do not need to offer my son as he needed to, though God did stay His hand, of course. I do not need to leave necessarily where I am and go to a place that God will show me. That was a message for Abraham. I have quite a different role in God's plan. It's for that reason that we need to look to the Bible and first recognize that it is divided into parts. It has two major parts, the Old Testament, which has 39 books, and the New Testament, which has 27 books. The Old Testament has books of law, of history, of poetry, major prophets, and minor prophets. The New Testament opens up with a biography of the life of Jesus Christ. It then has a book of history, followed by a series of letters or epistles, both to churches and to individuals. And it closes with a great apocalypse, the revelation of Jesus Christ that tells us about heaven and makes that place more desirable. When we get into the Bible, we need to realize that God's plan for us is to be found within the teachings of Jesus Christ. He is God's spokesman for today. In order to understand Him, we must learn simple rules. Look for figures of speech, common figures that you and I use every day of our lives, and take the Bible the way it's written. Some things are written as figures of speech and ought to be understood that way. When Jesus says that we should forgive unto 70 times 7, the chances are that He didn't really mean for us to multiply out and say, okay, all I've got to do is forgive somebody 490 times. Instead, He was giving a massive number, a perfect, 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 7 times 7 times 10 in order to get that number. And that perfect, perfect, perfect is the way you and I need to respond. That's a beautiful way to express it, but we need to see it for what it is. It is figurative in nature. We need then to also realize how God authorizes, that when He gives a specific command, He expects us to follow it out exactly as delivered. When He gives a general command, that we are given some latitude. We can choose what we want to use to carry out the command as long as whatever we choose is legal. We've come to the realization in our study that there are some things that are incidental, as it were. They expedite our carrying out a command, but they do not in any way cause us to violate it. On the other hand, there are some things, because they are coordinate or equal, that we cannot grab hold of. Jesus could never be a priest in the tabernacle because He was from the wrong tribe. And that demonstrates to us the importance of silence in the economy of God. I truly hope that these lessons have benefited you, and that now you will read with greater understanding to hear God speak.
Heaven's joy so bright and sun. Still be mine.